Hello, anatomy colleagues. This is Dr. Alsip, and I am super excited to discuss these unique anatomical areas, which we refer to as the dural venous sinuses. So as its name would suggest, we are talking about regions associated with the cranial dura. We've mentioned these in a few other lecture videos as they play important roles in regards to cerebrospinal fluid drainage, as well as in regards just to the meninges in general. But in this video, it will be all dural sinuses all the time. They are the star of the show. We are going to focus on locations and where these will eventually drain on their path back to the hearts. Okay, let's start with a review of what forms the dural venous sinuses. These are specifically located between the two layers of the cranial dura, with a few exceptions. So, the meningeal dura will reflect away from the periosteal dura, and there will be a formation of the dural venous sinuses. So, say here is the periosteal dura here. The meningeal dura is going to reflect away from it. And what you're left with is this area here, which is a dural venous sinus. Now, for our purposes, we can think of them as like veins. Not veins per se, but like them in terms of function. They are draining blood from the brain and internal cranium to return to the heart like a good vein does. They are very structurally sound in terms of not collapsing because of their attachment to the bone with this periosteal dura. Most venous sinuses will eventually, in one way or another, drain into the internal jugular vein, or your IJV, which is formed by the coalescence, or the joining, of the inferior petrosal sinus with the sigmoid sinus. So let's talk about some of the specific dural venous sinuses, and we will start with the two that are associated with the fulx cerebri, which is one of those dural partitions or infoldings. It's specifically that dural partition that's located within the longitudinal cerebral fissure. Arguably the longest dural venous sinus will be your superior sagittal sinus. You can see how long it is extending. It runs in that superior border of the fulx cerebri and is very close to the bones of the calvaria. This sinus is also important in terms of CSF drainage, as while CSF will drain into other sinuses, this is typically one of the major drainage sites. The superior sagittal sinus will drain into this area here, where multiple sinuses will drain, as its name would suggest, which is called the confluence of sinuses. Oops. Didn't mean to mark through that, but confluence of sinuses. We'll talk about the other sinuses that drain there in a moment. The inferior sagittal sinus will run in the inferior concave free border of the fulx cerebri, which I'm outlining right here, and it will join with the great cerebral vein, which you can see here. They will join together to form the straight sinus, which I'm outlining there. All right, let's return to the confluence of sinuses, and it's just what it sounds like. It is an area where many sinuses come together and drain blood into one region, and it's typically located just lateral to the internal occipital protuberance, that portion of the occipital bone. And you can often clearly see where it existed on dry bone because it creates a notable divot in the bone next to the internal occipital protuberance. So three dural sinuses, venous sinuses, will drain here. You will have the superior sagittal sinus, as we mentioned before, that straight sinus, which is formed by the coalescence of the inferior sagittal sinus and the great cerebral vein, will be the second. And the third sinus is the occipital sinus, which is associated with the fulx cerebelli, which is one of the other dural partitions that's going to be located between the cerebellar hemispheres. The confluence will continue drainage as the paired transfer sinuses. So if this is the confluence where those three sinuses are draining, it will continue both right and left. Excuse me, this would be the right and this would be the left. So it will continue into these transverse sinuses. All right, Let's talk the cavernous sinus. This sinus is so cool that we're going to talk about this in a whole other session as well, in that orbit and cavernous sinus session. And these are the cavernous sinuses. The cavernous sinuses are really more of a venous plexus, which is kind of these extremely thin-walled veins. This is why it's depicted here as more of a complex than, say, perhaps this larger sagittal sinus or the transverse sinuses. There are a right and a left cavernous sinus, which communicate with one another through venous channels referred to as the intercavernous sinuses, and these are going to be anterior and posterior to the infundibulum of the pituitary. So you'll have these complex of sinuses on both the right and the left side. I like to think of them on either side of the cella turcica region. Now, many veins of the brain will drain here, such as cerebral veins, as well as ophthalmic veins, and it's through these ophthalmic veins that infections often enter into the cavernous sinuses, if they're going to enter into the cavernous sinus. The cavernous sinuses will eventually drain into the superior and inferior petrosal sinuses, and this is just depicting kind of these generally. And we will discuss this next concept, this next point right here, in more detail in the orbit and cavernous sinus session, but there is a lot of important neurovasculature which will either travel directly through the lumen of the cavernous sinus, such as the internal carotid artery or your abducens nerve or cranial nerve 6, or through the associated lateral walls of the sinus, such as the oculomotor or the trochlear nerve or the ophthalmic or first division of the trigeminal nerve. So imagine an infection enters into this region and you have all that neurovasculature in there. It can really greatly affect the structures in there. Think of the innervation of the extraocular eye muscles, which are innervated by cranial nerves 3, 4, and 6. So that could have tremendous implications in terms of the movement of the extraocular eye muscles. So like I said, we will return to this concept in more detail in that session 10, but I did want to bring it up here because it's kind of a cool subject. The last dural venous sinus I want to discuss in greater detail are the sigmoid sinuses, of which there are two, a right and a left. And so right about at the area of the petrous part of the temporal bone, the transverse sinus will kind of quickly or more directly head inferiorly in a kind of abrupt curve shape. And where this occurs, there's a name change to the sigmoid sinus. These sinuses will join with the much smaller inferior petrosal sinuses to form the internal jugular veins at the level of the jugular foramina. So say the jugular foramina is going to be like here-ish. At that point, the name changes to the internal jugular vein. Now, here is a schematic of the dural venous sinus drainage. The lines indicate where the sinuses are draining, so kind of in this region here. So we know that the inferior sagittal sinus joins with the great cerebral vein to form the straight sinus, and we know that straight sinus eventually makes its way to the confluence of sinuses. The confluence of sinuses will have the transverse sinuses that turn into the sigmoid sinuses and the internal jugular vein. So you can kind of get an idea of what we're meaning in terms of this schematic. So not perfect, not drawn to scale, but I do think it kind of gets the point as to what sinuses drain into which to eventually make their way to the internal jugular veins. I highly recommend you create your own version of this for your studying, and I would love to see your versions if you're proud of them. I'd like to see them. I would even recommend next to your boxes or whatever you end up drawing, jotting down a few notes as to where you would find that particular dural venous sinus. I think will be a helpful practice. All right, as always, I like to finish off with a question. Question is, which of the following does not typically drain directly into the confluence of sinuses? Is it A, the occipital sinus, B, the sigmoid sinus, C, the straight sinus, or D, the superior sagittal sinus? All right, what do you think the correct answer is? It is going to be B, the sigmoid sinus. These other three do actually drain directly into the confluence of sinuses, most typically, whereas the sigmoid sinus is distal to the confluence of sinuses. All right, that was a lot of fun. Please take time to review these concepts, and I look forward to discussing these concepts if you have questions. Thank you for your time and attention.